We present Jimmy by Desmond Hogan with P.G. Stevens and Pauline Delaney. Jimmy.
Sun's rising red over the Thames. It'll be a fine day.
I wouldn't bank on that.
Are you cold?
Not as cold as I was last week.
Spring's coming. How about this Anne Kerry about that?
That it was time to plough furrows in the mud.
Hit the road?
Yes.
What have you got left, huh?
Wee sounds jaws.
You're living in style these days.
£200 for a brooch. Oh. Well, my mother gave it to me and I kept it all these years. She called it her darling jewel. She got it from a young man in a merchant family in Limerick. He used to take her out. They'd walk by the Shannon. And one dark night, he did to her what the confraternity priests warned him about.
That delicious act of sex that conceived you.
It was more than sex for her. It was like the Holy Ghost. After all, he was from a class way above her.
What happened?
She had me.
Oh.
She brought me up on her brother's farm where they had a mad child. They locked him in with the chickens so no one would know. And one day they found him, but it was too late. He probably still thinks he's a chicken. It was the same with me, not that my mother minded. The neighbors looked at me as if I were a class of a goon.
That started you.
Oh.
Fruit of the vine.
The sweet taste of Spanish wine. I inherited from my father, I would often tell myself. They brought wine from Spain to Limerick, up the mouth of the Shannon to the tables of merchants and priests and redemptorists' missions.
Where did he go?
Who?
Your father.
To Boston.
And she never heard from him.
No, but always at Christmas she'd send a Christmas card to him at his address in Limerick, though she knew he was gone and that it would probably not reach him. A man from Listowel, a cobbler, made Christmas cards from coloured paper and tinsel and had greetings in our native tongue. Far be it from me to say they never reached this man in Boston, Massachusetts. My mother remained in love with him to her dying day when I left.
I've been Dublin. I've tried both cities. In Dublin, the wino is an enigma and social outcast. London provides certain hallowed spots, a bed for many misfits outside Charing Cross Station. I even stayed in a squat once. An old woman called Madge burnt it down. It is probably best. The place stank of urine. Young people lived in the other houses. They passed us as though disgusted by us. I was mainly drunk while I was living there. Not drunk enough not to notice the cornflowers and the grass outside. You're always the one to see the flowers, Mary told me in my sojourn outside Charing Cross. But how could one not notice them? These days the embankment is ablaze with crocuses. We wake, we sleep, we rise. I'll see you in the spring if I don't see you on the mattress, Mary says, before we sleep at night. It's spring now. The Thames stinks to heaven but bears gentler redolences.
If you listen, I'll sing you sweetly.
One of these days I'll rise like the Irish poet Raftery and set foot to the roads, because spring is here and the call of the roads is high and intense and wanton.
You're not coming in here.
It was the song I wanted to hear.
I called the police. You have an option.
And you and I, Irishman, like myself.
Jimmy! Jesus, Mary and Joseph, where have you been?
I was staying in a little hotel.
Where did you get the money?
I put a bet on a horse called Sailing racing in Kildare and I won £100. Oh. The next day a horse called Mutiny was racing in Paris. I won £200. I'm a rich man.
So you left us. You look cleaner. Jesus Christ, I never saw you with a naked jaw. The coat, holy mother of God, the court. You wouldn't see the Duke of Wellington in one like that.
I'm leaving.
You're what?
I'm going back to Ireland.
After all these years?
It hasn't been so long.
30 years?
A lifetime. Merely a lifetime. Crossing the Irish Sea. Sound of water milking memory. You hear the sound of a rebel song. Night comes to the lavatory, to the restaurant, to the drunken spittle. All you see now, Jimmy Carty, are gulls, shining pearly gulls. Your Aunt Mary once said to you, the world is made of diamonds. She was from Galway and found a topaz ring by the Clyde steps one day. She wore a black shawl and ever after would go to the quays looking for diamonds.
Have you got a light?
No, I don't smoke.
Now, what are you staring at the sea for?
Huh?
Do you want to see the Loch Ness Monster, huh?
I can't sleep.
Oh, like myself. Now, look at the ship passing out there. We'll soon be in Dublin. I'm dying to see my daughter again.
You live in Dublin?
No. No, I went to Birmingham to spend my old age.
Oh.
I have a son there. Anyways, it's not the nicest where I live, but my daughter stays. Sean McDermott Street. She wouldn't move for £1 million, she says. She likes the chat. She likes the women. She loves her husband, who beats her up. I had to go. I'd seen Jim Larkin rising like a crocus, trying to raise the working people. Now all there is to set them up at the high-rise flats in Ballymun. No, I prefer Birmingham. There are flowers in our garden there.
I live in London myself.
Do you never shave?
Sometimes.
Well, you better before you see the Wicklow Mountains. Keep the appearances up, old man. Keep the appearances up.
I'll shave before breakfast.
The hairs are turning white now, eh? Isn't old age a strange thing? You wink at it and it's around you. You think you're just getting on a bit when you're told you're bordering on the headstone. That's what my son-in-law told me. That's my other daughter's fella. He lives in London. He left the daughter and her three children in Coventry. But I went down after him with Imelda, and he told me I was bordering on the grave and that Imelda was bordering on middle age. Now she's 27 and he's 30. He was living with a young one who looked at me as though I was a field of spuds. Young people, they know very little. I was just saying to Imelda, I'd never go back to Ireland the way the young carry on, laying bombs. I said, I'd never return until they lay bombs in Birmingham. Well, that was the end. Bombs under the pub table. There's no point hesitating then, I said. No point waiting. It's all around you. Bombs. A woman shouted, up the ya-ya-ra at me last week. Well, I punched her in the mouth. The ya-ya-ra be damned. And the UVF. And the rest of the bloody bastards. The walking man is all important. But they use him for their every move. It's like a chess game. And he's the plaything. Rabbi damned. English, Irish, we're the people who matter. And all they do is put bombs under our tables or dole calves on our fists. It's time to rebel, I tell my son. But sure, he looks at me as though I'd be locked up with a dog outside one of these days. We might as well be dead, we old people.
There's Ireland.
Oh, Jesus, Mary and Joseph, the sugar loaf. Oh, kiss me.
Is it that long?
Since I saw it. light years, 1969. Oh, my daddy brought us there the week before the big strike in 1913. He plucked marigolds from a rich woman's garden, brought them home, and planted them in our garden. I hope you see them tomorrow.
What?
The flowers of 1913. Ah, you shaved. Oh, you look a nicer man. Well, come on now. Hurry up with your breakfast, or we'll be here until the boat goes back to Liverpool. Tell me.
Hmm?
What sort of background are you from? I mean, you're not Dublin. Oh, you're from the country, yes, but, it's a bit of the gentry in your way of talking. Oh, I know your types. You're addicted to something, aren't you, huh? Aye, but more. You come from a family that isn't common. Now, if there's one thing our family can always tell, it's someone a cut above the normal. Now, we're used to fine houses, remember? These might be, run-down tenements now, but once they were the property of the elite. A man came to our house from the National Museum and he said that we had rare stucco walk over the lavatory. Fancy that now, huh? Oh, we're used to the airs of the ascendancy. Blue walls that are falling apart and cupids white as icing in the lavatory to lessen the pain, the hunger, the sleepless nights with seven bawling children. There's a lot to be thankful for, isn't there?
Aye.
Tell us, what sort of family do you come from?
A troubled one.
The green grass of Ireland in spring. At Tullamore, there's a young boy with blonde hair. I remember the priest raising a chalice to the supreme god in Galway in spring when Franco won the war in Spain and O'Duffy came back, expired with prayers, with battering the heathen walls. And I remember you, Tommy Joe Sinclair, on Barna Strand.
Oh, lovely day.
You can see for miles.
As far as America.
Further.
Soon I'm heading there.
Where?
America.
After your exams?
Yeah. To San Francisco.
The land of milk and honey, huh?
The land of milk and honey.
And as bombs crashed over London, Tommy Joe Sinclair, 21, died in a headlong collision in Pacifica, 10 miles south of Golden Gate Bridge. That was the year I left Ireland, 1942. Funny coincidences are, they start, they never finish. Oh yes, Jimmy Carty, remember Galway and the bed of mud left by the Claddagh when the sea withdrew. Remember the ship that stood a week there before you left Ireland, like an omen, paralytic, somber, yet serene.
Thirty years
since you've seen me.
Jimmy.
You're a professor now.
I thought you were dead.
Hmm?
In 1960 or thereabouts, I heard you'd been seen in Dublin among the down and outs.
Hmm.
Is that true? Here, have some wine.
Thank you. Spanish wine. This place has changed its airs. The new hotels and the young people who looked like they were out of a musical.
Jimmy, where have you been all these years? The world's changed. You've changed. We've all changed. Even the college here.
It used to be easy.
And now?
Now the students call me upheaval. You see, I've put on weight.
I see.
It's not easy.
Being heavy?
No.
You're still lecturing old Irish?
Yes, and medieval studies.
Ah.
I go to green places with young cynics to look at the Irish saints, Bridget or Colum Killen and Orway. There's a view from the window which looks on...
On crocuses?
Yes. Mm. But I often wonder what it is that separates human from human, that invokes obesity, ugliness...
Pain?
Yes.
Truth to tell, I'm forgotten.
No. A poet may be rejected by his own country. He is never forgotten.
A poet?
Didn't you write about the waves once in the Connor Tribune?
Look, out there. You can see County Clare.
Oh, we must go there sometime. There are many castles in Clare.
Sometimes you'd think, wouldn't you? It's all too good.
To be true?
Life is too beautiful.
It's what you make it.
Well, sometimes you make a mistake.
Huh?
Mistake, love for hate or vice versa. Beauty for ugliness.
I cannot see how that could be possible.
You've lived longer than me. It's a knowledge that must be yours other than mine.
I know more. Hmm?
You must.
Knowing more. I was 26 then. He was 17. I was schoolmaster. He was pupil. He wore white starched collars. I wore grey. I'd been to that National University. He'd been to Erin once, never to Dublin. He'd studied Ovid. Cicero would prefer Emily Bronte. I was his English teacher in a school run by brothers. It was general knowledge in Galway that I had a bent to literature, and as such I was respected and feared. The Irish loving language, hating truth. We were friends, Tommy and I. Nothing more. Let that be stated. But the men and women of Galway had a clear glint in their eye for scandal.
A pint of Guinness, please. Thank you.
Well, there you are. You've ordered your drink. Dubonnet, please. Jimmy, today we're going to drive to see Rita.
I thought I was never to go back there. Family with political connections. The house was big and white. It had deer's heads inside, lines of flowers appropriate to the seasons outside. There was one palm tree in the back garden, attended by a circle of snowdrops in spring. Its wallpaper was surprisingly decorative. Here I was born. I did well at school. Elaine also surpassed herself. We were the brightest students in University College Dublin. We touched shoulders with people who later became well-known in one field or another, literature mainly. An oval-headed lady who became internationally famous after jotting a short story on her thesis. A pub ruffian whose books now bear fancy designs in London bookstores. A young man, very small, who went to the Spanish Civil War, was killed. Recalled in Dublin, though, for the tallness of his girlfriend. Our home's name, Annamede. Galway, 1937, the year I returned from Dublin. I took up a teaching post. I was honored by a party. It was there I first caught sight of Tommy.
May I introduce my son? He's going to your school. You'll have him for English soon. Oh, I'm sure there's a lot he can learn from you.
Jim! My sweet Jesus, you've changed! whiskey? Wine?
Wine, thank you.
What has happened to you? Well, God's blessing on your homecoming. This house often sighed for you. It's an alcoholic you were all these years, is it? Oh, Jimmy, I should have offered you orange juice. Jimmy, I prayed for you.
I know.
There was a time I stopped believing, but I continued going to Mass just to pray for you. There's a bit of palm in my missal I plucked the day you left. Palm Sunday 42. He's been there since. Oh, yes, we had reports of you. An Irish priest told a nun in Galway you were among the down and outs in London. What an end to our
lineage. Poets and scholars. Our land was once famous for literature and art. Now our artist must go among the down and outs of London for sustenance.
Oh, come now, Jimmy wasn't an artist.
He was a human being.
A human being. It would have been worse for him in Russia.
Chains, let's face it, we've all been living in chains. This country has been living in chains.
I was happy.
Happy? Lord save us, I'll make tea. To think it was all over a young fellow.
Jimmy's heard enough about that.
Not all, though. Not all. A boy. A relationship. I can see it now behind Rita's eyes. The truth. Maybe I shouldn't have gone, but going was inevitable. It charted a country, a lifetime. A set of images which perplex and make enigmatic the sense of living, of surviving. I say now, crossing the verger of Galway, I have no need of wine. Wine, porter, was given unto man as the cross was given to Christ. I'm without need to crucify myself now. I am whole.
Your first time in Dublin.
It won't be the last.
We're like culprits, going like this. Tell me, what do you want to see first?
The National Gallery. I believe the Goyas are supreme.
My husband, George.
Pleased to meet you.
We met before.
I don't remember.
A long time ago. You're the fellow who ran away with my cousin.
Your cousin?
Tommy Joe Sinclair. And stayed with him in Boswell's Hotel in Dublin.
All alone, all alone, by the sea.
It was at a crossroads dance near La Banne. George came up to me the week after going to Dublin with Tommy. I hadn't realized he hadn't asked permission. I hadn't realized that for him it was a getaway from one of Galway's patrician families. I hadn't realized how much of an outcry attended our visit as we overstayed a few days, looking at the zebras in the zoo.
Tiger, tiger, burning bright in the forest of the night.
Right.
Truth is a strange thing. Brings men far. I'm going to the States on leaving school.
Searching for truth?
You could say that.
Won't be long.
3 months. 3 months and there'll be no more Galway or Athenry.
3 months and I won't see you again.
It was nice knowing you.
Nice.
Yeah, I learnt a lot from you. Learned to look beyond...
What is chosen by society for reverence.
Yeah. I learned there were no rules.
For some rules. Most of them irrelevant.
To what?
Love. They were right, I suppose. We had fallen in love in a sense that weekend. In the sense... Oscar Wilde loved a white-shirted young gentleman who epitomized serenity. The serenity wrought by extreme beauty. How did they guess?
Love is a strange thing. Comes once or twice. Came when I was 18. I'm sorry, Jimmy. I'm sorry. We've got to get out, got to go. They're threatening us. I didn't mean it. I didn't mean to hurt you as much as I've done. To you, it was to be a weekend looking at golden-crusted books in Dublin bookstores. To you, it was a trip approved of by my parents. To me, it was, from the beginning, a deceit. I deceived you into thinking I was accepted by my parents. I deceived them into thinking I was playing a hurling match. It was my answer to Ireland. My final answer. To you, it was a sort of wish fulfillment. 18 is a strange age, you say. You talked much to me of relationships. I just want to say I'd related to you. Few people relate to one another, do they? Now again, it's the train to Dublin, the ship sailing to New York. It's moments like this that shape life. Moments of farewell. What else is of importance? Moments as in Boswell's Hotel, Dublin, when over a white lane table, like lovers, we partook of spring lamb.
He went, June 1939, true to form. Left me with a view of Clare across the bay. Much recrimination. It wasn't easy, going on.
Fancy meeting you again. 'Tis queer with the drink you've been.
George.
Yes, drink. The old codger drink. The old curse. Sure, if it wasn't for Guinness.
It was wine Jimmy took to when he had his nervous breakdown. Jimmy was cultured.
Cultured.
Funny he'd never drank before.
It's extraordinary.
He's looking awful.
Funny, though, the shape of his face is appearing. I'm glad he's staying with you, not me. George thinks he should be put out in the bog like the cows.
He is welcome.
Funny how a man can start drinking who's never drank before.
Jimmy had problems.
The boy.
Oh, can't you see that was an exaggeration? It wasn't a boy. It wasn't the drink, Lisa Love. It was life, can't you see? Life. Here in Galway City, they're building suburban houses white as wedding cakes that bishops bulging at the waists are blessing with water. Can't you see we're still surrounded by it? A problem history hasn't solved. That no round of aperitifs can drown. Life. I hope you're comfortable, Jimmy.
Very.
You're looking so well. That grey jumper I bought you looks so well on you. Properly shaved with that haircut. You look like Ray Milland. Oh, Jesus, Mary and Holy Saint Joseph. I forgot how stunningly beautiful you could look. You had Mama's good looks. Jimmy, why? Why all these years of absence?
God only knows.
Tell me, leaving, going away like, was it hard?
As far as I remember, it was extremely easy. You see, I'd been drinking for 3 months. Leaving Galway, I was like a ship taking to the ocean, a dark, illimitable ocean whose boundaries were drawn by war.
You were very unhappy.
No, not so much unhappy. Dazed, distressed. For 3 years, people had shunned me over a single event. I was treated as though I had leprosy. A curse on you, Bedside, as St. Luke says. And that was the thought that stuck in my throat. I had many enemies, too many. Everyone was my enemy, and I took to drink. Then, to the illimitable ocean of living, and for 30 years I've strayed like a mongrel through London. Oh, yes, there was a week or two in Edinburgh, once in Dublin. Yes, that was in 1960.
Oh.
Yeah, I returned. Gene Kelly was singing, singing in the rain in the Metropole. It didn't seem like Ireland. I stayed in the Morning Star. I left after 3 days. Ireland has no place for derelicts.
Sir, lining the roads.
The tinkers, you mean?
Yes.
Yes. Lining the roads where the rich grow richer and the fat grow fatter. But it's an emotional poverty I left, a forgotten heritage. In London, I met many of my kind. Winos are not imbeciles. Many craftsmen driven from their craft. Lovers betrayed by love, poets betrayed by poetry. It was an intelligent world to wander in for 30 years, if nothing else.
Is this a judgment?
A judgment on Ireland. Yes.
It wasn't easy coming back. Less simple observing the happiness, peace, contentment of children. Oh, why does this innocence always have to go? Still, it's lovely, walking through Galway, crossing water. The sky is white these days, white as metal. I pass schools where prayers rise, hymns to Mammon. I eventually come to Pádraig O'Connor's statue. Porky little man who once walked to Moscow to see Chekhov, found he wasn't in town that weekend.
We'll have a party for you.
A party?
Wouldn't that be exciting? Some special dish. Veal, maybe. Wine. Oh, God, not wine. Lemonade, if needs be. We will celebrate. Nothing like a party. Oh, look, isn't the view out of the window something? The sea and all. Elaine! Wasn't it a painter who said you were the best hostess in Galway?
The sea's a beautiful colour.
Summer's coming.
Candles.
It's more than we ever have. You light them, Jimmy.
Right. One for love, one for luck, and one for happiness.
What was it about young Sinclair that made a teacher like you and a man of sound background lose his head?
George.
Well, I'm curious. It's time to speak in the open.
He was drinking before he came here.
It's a serious question.
We're having roast duck a la française. Oh, isn't the candlelight beautiful?
It's romantic, isn't it? Yes, that's something I must introduce in my new restaurant. Candlelit suppers.
For the nuns to puke over. Elaine, let us say grace, and let us thank God our brother is home.
Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, is this a party or a Bible reading? Yes, it was a pity Tommy Joe died so young. A grand fellow.
George.
I'm entitled to talk of my cousin.
It's the Guinness. Would the corrup run dry without it?
Would the sea run riot if not for the store of gombeans as island holds? Would the Atlantic stop breaking if not for the idiocy displayed by a nation of shopkeepers?
Mm. George is not a shopkeeper. Mm. He's a restaurant owner. Oh. Let us eat.
God bless the cookbook.
Rita. Look, Rita. Jimmy is smiling again.
George spoke of the Vatican Council that night. Time to forgive, time to forget, he says, leering at me as though I was a hyena. Talk about everything. Couples are copulating on the screen of the Astoria. Open the floodgates, let the pornography in. They won't know Tommy Joe about us, will they? They'll never know, even if 1,000 couples fornicate in Air Square. Some things in this morass of living are justified. Some things are private.
The hills of Clare.
Barnet Pier. I never thought I'd see the day.
It's all young people who live here now. Hmm? Hippie youngsters, mothers always pregnant, young men with moon eyes.
Do they ever think that there's another world?
Where?
Among those of our generation.
Our memories?
No, the present that is always with us.
Old curtains, old sofas. Things like the curtains with patterns of sparrows. Romantic yearnings. Romantic modes in an oppressive time.
Listen. The kids shouting. Everywhere I go, children laugh. Tell me, where's Joe now?
Joe? I told you. In Brussels.
Oh, yes. Big job. EEC.
Yes.
My younger brother. I'd love to see him again.
One of these days, he might be back. Your brother, Jimmy.
Joe, am I dreaming?
You don't remember him.
Jimmy, I found your books of Siegfried so soon, years after you were gone. It was from your text I learned French.
Joe has one of the top jobs in the EEC in Brussels.
Oh. Congratulations.
Let's go. Tonight we'll celebrate in Galway.
I'm pleased to meet you.
Oh,
together again. Did you ever dream you'd see the day?
They say families must make it up sometime.
This is not making it up.
How's Brussels?
Boring. Boring. Secretaries with big bottoms, high-rise flats. Oh, it's the trips to Paris or Amsterdam that appeal to me.
The high life. Last year, George and I went to Paris. Oh, what a fool he made of himself in a pub.
Yeah.
He got drunk and started chasing a waitress with hair like margarine.
Well, at least I don't have some people's obsessions.
Look, it's getting dark outside. A plane has gone by overhead.
Some party. If I come here again, I'll go through the floor.
I have a surprise. I'm going to throw a party myself.
In Anamede.
In Anamede.
Glad to meet you. All these years I've wondered about you.
You look the youngest of the lot of them, and the most content.
Life is boring. I'm serving mammon. A high salary, young flesh, the odd remarkable secretary, good wine, the occasional trip to Tokyo. I'm a servant of the nation.
Look, there's a moon over the sea tonight.
So there is. It was all so regrettable, wasn't it?
Huh?
I grew up in a generation apart from yours, but you left traces. Mama always looked sad when spring came. It was all such a harsh affair. Exaggerated, really.
Exaggerated? Nothing was exaggerated, all was true. I had a friendship at a time friendship was banned. The young boy spoke as though he was in love.
And were you?
With life. That's rare. It was rare then. Life is a prurient substance to be avoided. That is the secret.
The spring always seemed like magic to me in Anamede. I knew I had a dead brother when I was growing. That's what I'd been told. Years later, I discovered I was 17. There were traces of you everywhere, you know. Traces in the spring. The odd book. A flower that somehow was rare, and as such suggested rumor, gossip.
That was not uncommon.
My parents accuse you of sodomy.
It's insane.
Well, why else were we staying in a hotel together when I should have been playing hurling?
It's mad.
I know. That's why I'm going. Next Monday. Hey, before I go, let's go to Claire. It can't make any difference now.
Not to you. What about me?
Get out. You're much too talented. But why be affected by their obscene minds? There's a universe without. You say that yourself. And it's not just in books.
You can see County Clare tonight. So still. Perfect.
A tranquil view. It's rare in the modern world.
Jimmy's going to live here with me.
It's like the end of a fairy story.
I've forgotten how it all began.
Jimmy's leave-taking. I'm sure there were many such incidents in Irish history.
Please, Jimmy, you know you can't come back. Don't try.
But one last time. I want to see
Mammy
Joe.
Mammy and Daddy won't have it.
But why? Why? Don't you see? It was rumours.
Rumours of drink. Look at you, like a tramp on the meadow. Go, Jimmy. Come back
when... When they're dead.
Welcome, Jimmy. Welcome.
It's good to have you back. Meet Mrs. O'Donnell.
Let us toast my brother, Jimmy Carty. He's been away a long time. He is now back. Cheers.
Cheers. Jimmy, we were looking for you. Where have you been?
Looking at Gilt Edge books I used to read to Joe.
Come. A lot of people are dying to meet you.
So nice to have Jimmy back. He keeps me company. I was beginning to feel lonesome. Look over there. He's talking to a young boy. The image of Tommy Joe Sinclair.
George, you shouldn't be saying such things.
Carty is a bloody disgrace. Who is Jimmy anyway? Where did he come from?
Life with the EEC is boring. In fact, you could say life is boring. It's extraordinary being here. The parish priest is here. Old maids are here. All young when Jimmy left. It's like a dream. Why did he go? It doesn't make sense. And my only real memory of him was one of them reading The Happy Prince by Oscar Wilde. Tears coming to his eyes.
You're the long-lost brother.
Yes.
I heard of you.
What did you hear?
Well, that you once wrote a poem in the Connor Tribute about waves.
Jimmy. He's pleasant company, really. There he is, smiling. The boy he's speaking to has golden hair. Wouldn't he remind you of Tommy Joseph?
There. The boy Jimmy is talking to has taken up a record, putting it on. Mrs. O'Donoghue's son. He's the problem child, Mrs. O'Donoghue says. Went to do pottery, wandered around like a gypsy, gave it up. He's in some weird religion now.
Why did you give up the pottery?
I wanted something else. I joined the Divine Light group in Galway. My mother thinks I'm crazy. Yeah, I suppose I am. I'm still looking, though. I keep looking. Can't think it'll stop here. Why did you come home?
To visit my family.
How long are you going to stay?
Not long.
It'll be so nice to have Jimmy stay with us.
By Desmond Hogan. The part of Jimmy was played by P.G. Stevens. Mary, Ethne Dunn. The woman on the boat, Catherine Gibson. And Tommy, Bosco Hogan. Elaine was played by Pauline Delaney. Rita, Carmel McSharry. George, Kevin Flood. And Joe, by Sean Barrett. The music was arranged and directed by John Anderson, and sung by Hilary Shields. The oboist was Valerie Taylor. The play was directed by Robert Cooper.